let's be Stormy, and here is your horoscope for February 2020. And I tell you what, I think it's an interesting month. Your ruling planet is going to go retrograde, and it's going to go retrograde in an energy it's not entirely comfortable in. So I do think that you might experience a little bit of discomfort within yourself and within your relationships this month as well. But that is par for the course, because sometimes you got to get a little uncomfortable so that you can actually grow and expand. Now, the other thing I kind of want to bring to your attention before we jump in and start talking about all the good stuff that's happening for you this month, I want to bring your attention just right here at the beginning of the month to your sixth house, okay? We've got the Sun and Mercury both traveling over here in the sixth house right as we're coming into the month. And I just want you to pay attention to your health. Okay, this is an interesting energy ruled by, in the general, it is ruled by Aquarius. We've got Uranus, who is the ruler of Aquarius, up here in your ninth house. So this makes me think that this is like a random something that happens to your health, a random cold, a random sickness in some way, shape, or form. I don't think it's anything big and lasting to be afraid of. I actually think it's like a little blip on the map. But it is important, I think, because whatever it is, even if it's mental exhaustion, you're feeling like you're out of sync or feeling a little maybe even fatigued with your daily routine, something's asking you to adjust a little bit, right? To take on something a little bit different, but to pay attention to your health and your daily routine. And if you're doing, thinking, or in motion in anything that is making you crazy, Virgo, are you thinking something and it's actually wearing your energy down? So please pay attention to that, okay? Now, as we come in and we jump into this month on the 3rd, Mercury is actually going to move out of the energy of Aquarius and move up here into the energy of Pisces. Now, Mercury being your ruling planet, you're pretty familiar, comfortable with his communication, details, organizing, very much so being on top of tasks and information and things like that. Now, as Mercury moves his communicative energy into the energy of Pisces, Mercury wants facts and details and clarity, and Pisces is like, what is clarity, right? So it's a very in-between the world kind of energy. Pisces is your opposite energy, so we know that it's impacting your seventh house. Mercury is uncomfortable. Logic is not the food for nourishment for you this month. You have got to trust your intuition, trust your dreams, trust your emotions. For some reason, I think that Pisces this month may affect some of us in terms of hormones as well. This could definitely be a hormonal place that's happening for you in some way, shape, or form. So you kind of have to trust the things that are not exactly logic, factual, easy to grab the information. This is an energy too with Mercury coming here. I'm telling you, Virgo, empathy and listening are your friends. This is a time for you to be listening. Look, if you see here, majority of the planets are to the right of the chart or in the western side, which means it's not all about you this month. It is about you being about other people. It is putting other people's needs first, and then you will get everything that you need. Now, that does not mean you spend your last dollar to pay someone else's bills. You do not take from your life to give to someone else, but you give the energy that you do have to put people first, and you will see that it comes back to you. It's like whatever you put out, you get back three times as delicious, okay? So keep that in mind as you're looking here too. You're gonna need to listen in your relationships, especially your conscious, chosen one-on-one relationships. You've really got to listen here, okay? All right, On the 7th, we've got Venus moving up here into the energy of Aries. Now, Venus is also not that comfortable in Aries either, right? Venus wants to be about everybody. Let's just have harmony, be delicious. And Aries is like, no, let's do it now. Let's do it my way. This is about me, right? Which is an interesting thing because I just said it's not all about you, right? So this is an interesting placement to have. Now, what I love about Venus in Aries is Venus is your love. She is your money, right? This is your harmony, your diplomacy, your relationships. In Aries, Venus will not take a passive seat and just say, yeah, okay, you know, whatever you are thinking is good. Venus is going to ask for what she wants and what she needs up here in your eighth house. In your joint relationships, your most intimate connected relationships, whether it be with your spiritual teacher, your spouse, your parents, your tax accountant, whatever it is, Venus is going to ask for what she needs here. Venus is also going to highly magnetize this eighth house area of your chart. So one of the things that I think of in that magnetism is, if you are in the place and the position where you would like to be a part of some kind of conception, this is an area to make that happen between the eighth house, where we walk the line between life and death, right? And down here in the fifth house, where it's busy, you're maturing, you've got big things happening down here. So there could be ideas of conception of a new business, adoption of a child, conception of a child. If this is a challenging area for you, it will bring some hope over fertility issues as well. So keep that in mind as Venus is up there. Other things that can happen when Venus is in Aries. Venus in Aries is an impulsive energy. So you could be impulsively going after something in this area. You could be impulsively making decisions about finances, making decisions about taxes, making decisions about big things here. Some part of that is great because it makes you assertive enough to do it, and you've got some intuition that is very well lit up. But you do want to be mindful with what you're doing so that you don't have this like first thought impulse and then you walk yourself into a situation that's actually not very good for you. But allow Aries to be your warrior here, to fight for you, to move and to win, and to allow this magnetism of Venus to bring that love and that money into this area of your life, okay? On the 9th, we're going to have a full moon that's going to light up your 12th house space back here. It's in the energy of Leo. Now, Leo energy is creative, it's self-expressive, it's original, it's hard on our sleeve, it's childlike, it's very big. And this full moon back here says something needs to end, be acknowledged, or be adjusted, right? So in this energy, one of the things that I think of back here in the 12th house is that this is a house of closure and transition. We transition or we transition something out. It's a transformation house as well. So where in this 12th house area is it time to shed maybe a childish belief that you've had? Where is it time in this area to, in your 12th house area, in the place of you with you, where is it time to have joy, not just obligation, not just responsibility, not just doing, doing, doing? Where is it time for you to allow creativity and fun and play and letting your hair down and being easy back into your life, right? This full moon is certainly a signal that over the next 4 weeks, I need you to relax and breathe. Breathe. The world is big. Love big. Love out loud. Love you in solitude. This is a 12th house space. And allow this energy to permeate the rest of the chart as well, okay? And anything you have that has been hidden, maybe research that you've been working on, things like that, this is a great energy to wrap those up and get ready to launch them out into the public as we go forward. On the 16th, we've got Mars hightailing it into the energy of Capricorn, where he's like, high five, thank God I'm here. Mars in Capricorn, they like traveling together because Capricorn likes to do things. He wants to achieve. He wants to make solid material progress, right? And Mars just likes to do stuff. He's like, yeah, I'm energy. I'm boots on the ground. Let's get some things done. So here in the fifth house, your fifth house may be stimulated. You may find in February you are doing a lot with children, or the children in your life, or topics of children are highly, highly on your table. You are busy, you are in action, you are moving. I also think that Mars here in the fifth house is so brilliant for starting a new project, starting a new piece of an old project. Remember I talked about conception. What are you beginning here? And does it bring you joy? Is it a little bit scary, right? Because sometimes when you do the things that are brand new and you get ready to put yourself out into the world, Uranus, differently, it's a little bit scary. But Mars and Capricorn are going to help you get it done. The other thing I think of with Mars here in Capricorn is this question, Virgo, of are you in loving, laughing, and driving your life? Or is life driving you, right? Think about that. You are very good at being a doer, getting things done, being efficient. But here, you've had some energies that have said, hey, you can't just keep doing and being like you always have, because if you do that, you're going to just get what we've always got. So where do we need to allow the creativity, originality, and maybe something different more mature Saturn and Pluto energies to come through and take this to the next level, right? Take you out of your comfort zone here. It's a beautiful, beautiful energy. There is a little bit of pain that comes in the pleasure of growth, okay? Just keep that in mind. All right, when we get to the 17th, we've got Mercury, who's nicely up here in the energy of Pisces, moving into its retrograde time. Now, so Mercury is going to start his retrograde in the energy of Pisces before he dips back into Aquarius. Now, during a retrograde, right, we're going to reconnect, revisit, reunite, rethink, re-edit, reconsider all sorts of things. This retrograde is beginning here in your seventh house. So you could have relationships from the past come back. And I know some of you are just so tired. It's like, please stop bringing back these old lovers. I don't want them. I don't have anything to offer. But they could also pop into your head. And if an old lover just pops into your head, ask why. Ask what message they have brought. You don't have to completely re-engage. Ask what's the message they brought so that you can see it, because a retrograde will bring it back to bring it to closure, okay? This could also just be an old relationship that comes back on your table. Venus is in Aries up here. It's tax time. Are you having to communicate with your ex in some way, shape, or form about some financial things or something that is going on? Remember, with Mercury in Pisces and in retrograde here, my friend, logic is not your biggest piece of nourishment, which is hard when you're ruled by Mercury. You've got to trust your intuition. You do seem to have some strong financial positions and intuition available to you this month. So if you have to make financial decisions during this retrograde, really make sure you're reading the dotted line, all of that good kind of stuff, right? Just make sure you know exactly what it is that you are doing. Now, on the 19th, the sun is going to pop and move up here into this retrograde as well, right? So the sun brings light, heat, life, and vitality, and more so than anything, the sun brings motivation. So you are motivated with the sun here to do the work of this area, to do the work in your relationships, to do the work on the relationships in the past. And one of the biggest relationships I think you re-look at, Virgo, is the relationship of you with you. You with your body, you with your connection to the universe. So the sun has you motivated to go and to do these things. And it can also be quite motivating here as well, because maybe you're going back to a past idea and you have a donor, you have a collaboration, a cooperation, some kind of money that comes from sources that you didn't necessarily make it, but it's available to you to fund a new idea of maybe something you're beginning down here. You see the way the astrology ties together in the month? It's beautiful. Now, on the 20th, Jupiter, who's down here in your fifth house, is going to come into a sextile. And when the planets have sex, that's good for us, because not only is it a pocket of opportunity, of ease, it's available to you, but you will intelligently take advantage of taking action in this particular situation. Now, this sextile between your fifth house and your seventh house here, first of all, what it tells me and what it tells you is that this is an absolute progress energy. You can progress forward more quickly than you ever have. You get aligned with your goals really tightly, but what has to happen for you to make this progress is you've got to look back at relationships. You've got to look back at some belief, some relationship, some communication from the past, some idea, right? In order to have it come forward so that you can manifest it in a forward motion. The other thing I think is really important between the fifth house and the seventh house, the fifth house is my desires, my pleasure, my originality, my ideas, my true love of it, right? And my seventh house is where I actually commit. What are your ideals here? What are your ideals, right? If you don't know what your ideals are, if you don't have them down, pinned to paper, how can you know if you're growing into them? How can you know if you are making progress in where you're trying to take these areas if you have no idea where you've been and where you're going? So this is a time to realign with your goals, realign with your ideals, realign with what brings you joy, right? This is, you got to go with the flow and see what brings you joy. Release up here with this moon. You don't have to be in control of everything. You're going to have to let the flow take you. As we end this month on the 23rd, we're going to have a new moon happening up here in your seventh house as well. The sun and the moon come together in this conjunction. That's how we know it's a new moon. Now, this is where we plant these seeds of intention for new things in our relationships. And it doesn't have to be a new relationship. If you're single, you're trying to pull in a relationship, yes, plant those seeds of intention. It can be a fresh perspective on relationships, a fresh perspective with your relationship with the world, yourself, other people, boundaries that maybe you need to have with some people. What are you praying for? What's keeping you up at night? What's on your heart? What's in your head? Plant those seeds of intention here. The new moon is also in an energy where Mercury is going to be helping you here, right? It's going to help you see what you need to see to make the changes and adjustments to move forward. Now, the other thing I think of here in this relationship zone for you is conscious, chosen relationships that are significant and important to you. Are you spending enough time in them? Do you have ones that support Team Virgo as you move forward? Because this may be a very solitary time with it being Pisces energy, where you got to get by yourself and have conversations with people that you trust about your ideas of what brings you joy and how you'd like to step out into the world differently, about your passions, your desires, your creativity. But it may need to come from some solitude time of talking to people that you trust and then taking it into that solitude to evaluate it, okay? All right, Virgo, I think it's going to be a good month. Thank you for being patient with me as I learn this setup and the lights and all of the stuff. I love you so much. I look forward to seeing you next month. So please keep me posted on how everything is manifesting for you, okay? Like this video, comment, share, subscribe, and I'll see you in March. Bye.